welcome members,
visitors, and online guests to Philadelphia Christian Church, where we worship in spirit and in truth. These are your announcements.
Of course, the Lord will bless you for coming to church on Sunday, but if you want an upgrade on your blessing, we have a series of events throughout the week at Philadelphia Christian Church. From Monday through Friday, we have noonday prayer. On Tuesday, we have Bible study at 7 p.m., and on Thursday, we have school of prayer at 6 p.m.
Anyone interested in becoming a part of the nursing home ministry, there will be a meeting this Saturday, February 11th at 9 o'clock a.m. at the Pine Street location. This meeting is for new members and also existing members. Titus Ministry, there will be a meeting this Saturday at 11 o'clock a.m. at the Pine Street location. Philly family, don't forget, it's tax time. And if you need your 2016 church statement, please go to the Welcome Center for more information on how to retrieve your statement.
I got beans, creams, potatoes, tomatoes, lamb, chicken, turkey.
And that's right, Philly. And don't forget about the Grow Your Own Food Challenge. Whatever it is you want to grow, greens, beans, tomatoes, potatoes, you name it. Just don't forget also to take pictures throughout your progress. This Saturday night is marriage night. Join us for love, laughter, and great fellowship at Oakbourne Estates. All married couples are invited. See you there. Ladies and gentlemen, get your formal attire ready and mark your calendars for April 7th, 2017 for Philadelphia Christian Church 10th year anniversary celebration. The colors will be sapphire and diamond. Once again, that's April 7th, 2017 at 7 o'clock p.m. This week's Kids David featured business is Christina Learning Center. Christina Learning Center is a complete daycare solution for your kids. With children ages 6 weeks to pre-K, and the working hours are 6:30 a.m. to 5:45 p.m. with breakfast, lunch, and snacks provided. Bring your kids to a place where they can play, learn, and grow. Christina Learning Center is located 200 4th Street in Doosan, and call to reserve your spot at 337-316-6386. Christina Learning Center, a place where you can be sure that there's Christ in a learning center.
Philadelphia, y'all know this is one of my favorite parts of service, where we can worship and praise God, the God who died for you. We owe that to Him. So Philadelphia, get up off your feet. Get up off your feet.
Worship time, baby.
Hallelujah. Glory.
Hallelujah. He's an awesome God. Come on, y'all, give God some praise today. If you're happy to be in His house today, we serve an awesome God, and He's worthy of all praise. God, we come before You today, Lord God. Enter into Your gates with thanksgiving, Lord God, and into Your courts with praise, Lord God, singing unto You songs, Lord God. Father God, You are such amazing God, Lord God. Father God, we come to present ourselves as holy and a living sacrifice unto You. Father God, we just bless Your name today, Lord God. From our hearts, from our soul, Lord God, You deserve our hallelujah, Lord God. You deserve the highest praise this morning, Lord God. Just the fact that we woke up this morning and we stepped out our bed and we was in our right minds and we had a car to drive here and we came here, Lord God, in Your house, Lord God. That's a fact to bless Your name right there. That's a reason right there that we are still alive in Your house, Lord God. So, Father God, we just pray that You would accept our worship, Lord God, that You remove anything that is not of You, Lord God, and that You would be pleasing, Lord God, with our worship today, Lord God. So we magnify You, and we give You all the glory. And we say all these things
in Jesus' name.
Come on, let's lift them on high this morning. Hallelujah. Come on, y'all, put your hands together. Come to lift up the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hey, hey, yeah. Come on, we're going to sing this all together. Here we go. Say, Lord.
Lord of all and ruler of nations.
Come on, You are God.
You are God of all the earth.
Let all Your people praise.
Let all of Your people praise You.
And sing of Your marvelous.
And sing of Your marvelous work. Every knee shall bow before you.
And every tongue.
And every tongue will confess that you are Lord. Lord of all.
Come on, say yes you are.
Yes you are Lord. Lord. Marvelous word. Every knee shall bow before you.
And every tongue will.
And every tongue will confess
that you are.
That you are Lord. Oh, Lord of all.
Come on, bless his name right where you are.
Hallelujah.
He's a mighty God. Oh yes, God, you're so awesome, God. This is why we come here to bless you, our God. Come on, put your hands together. Hey, hey. Come on, if you know the Lord, He's holding your life. Somebody make some noise. I want y'all to say this, say, oh. Oh. Together. Here we go, y'all. faithful.
Faithful, faithful, faithful is our God.
He's faithful.
Faithful,
faithful,
faithful, faithful is our God. Harvest God promised me. Think back what the devil stole from me, and I rejoice today. For I shall recover it all. Yes, I rejoice today. For I shall recover it all.
Come on, we gonna say that again. Say faithful,
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 yeah.
He's faithful,
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 faithful is our God.
He's faithful,
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 faithful is our God. I'm reaping the harvest God promised me. Take back what the devil stole from me, and I rejoice today. I shall recover it all. Yes, I rejoice today. For I shall recover it all.
Come on.
He's holy,
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 holy, holy is our God.
My God is holy,
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 yeah.
Holy.
Come on, y'all.
Harvest God promised me.
Take it back.
Take back what the devil stole from me. And I rejoice today. For I shall recover it all. Yes, I rejoice today. For I shall recover it all.
Come on, somebody say his name. Jesus.
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 Jesus. Jesus is our God. Promise me, take back what the devil stole from me.
Stay right there.
I'm reaping the harvest God promised me. Take back what the devil stole from me. I'm reaping the harvest God promised me. Take back what the devil stole from me. I'm reaping the harvest God promised me. Take back what the devil stole from me. Promise me, take back what the devil stole from me.
Philadelphia.
I'm reaping the harvest God promised me. Take back what the devil
and
stole.
And I rejoice.
And I rejoice today.
Come on, somebody go.
And I rejoice today.
Here we go.
And I rejoice today.
Let's rejoice. Here we go.
And I rejoice today.
Oh, one more time.
And I rejoice today.
That's right.
For I shall recover it all.
that the devil stole. Woo. And we're taking it back. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. By your grace.
Me. Grace.
It raised me.
Grace. Father God, we give you praise, God, for your amazing grace, King. God, where would we be without your grace today, God? I know for myself, oh King, I would have a different life if it wasn't for grace, God. I wouldn't have the wife I have, the children I have. I for sure wouldn't have the job I have if it wasn't for grace, God. And your grace made it all possible, God. That day, Lord God, in 98, when you showed me your grace, God. How sweet the sound of it was, God, that saved a wretch like me, God. I was lost, but because of your grace, I got found, Father God. I was blind, but because of your grace, now I see. And God, I just give you praise, God, that you showed me that salvation wasn't about me, Lord God. It wasn't about even what I've done, Lord God, in life, Lord God. But salvation was about what you did for me, Lord God, at Calvary, God. And I want to thank you, Lord God, that not just me, God, but for everybody, Lord, that knows your grace in this sanctuary, God, and everybody that knows your grace that's worshiping on Sunday around the world, and everyone who's tasted your grace, God, since Calvary's Hill, Lord God. Oh, we are mighty grateful, God, for your grace. And your grace not only saves us, it keeps us, oh God. It keeps us, God, because sometimes, Lord God, hallelujah, this world can get a little rough out there, God. And your grace, hallelujah, keeps on keeping us, Lord God. Hey, when we eat, it's because of grace. And when we breathe, it's because of grace. And when we go to work, it's because of grace. And when we do anything that's pleasing in your sight, it's because of grace, Lord God. I thank you, Daddy, for by grace, God, it's all done. And when we get to glory, God, hallelujah. Oh, we gonna praise you, God, for that everlasting grace, God. For none of us will be able to boast that we did anything to deserve, God, to be in your presence, oh King. Hey! Hallelujah. We thank you, Daddy, for that grace. And now, Father, we are asking that you would transform this sanctuary to a grace distribution center, God, that this morning, God, hey, everybody that needs your grace could find it here, God, can get a taste of it, Lord God. We pray, King, that with joy we would draw waters, Lord, from the wells of salvation and grace this morning. There's some need grace for our healing and grace in their finances and grace in their marriage and grace with their kids and grace, Lord God, hey, with their health, whatever it is, God, whatever it is, we pray you give us what we don't deserve today, which is your amazing grace. Now, Father, bind out the devil in every manifestation, God. Bind him out in every way, God. Be with us from the beginning of this service all the way to the end, to where we take communion and celebrate your grace once again. So, Father, bless us, O King. Fill us with your spirit. And be with the word, Lord. And bind the devil out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, give God some glory for his grace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, come on. Hug a few people. Shake their hands. Tell them God's grace be upon you. God's grace be upon you. You see, because grace is favor. Grace is unmerited favor. God's grace be upon you. And everything you do, everything you touch, everywhere you go. Hey, may God's grace be upon you. And everything you do, everything you touch, everywhere you go, God's grace be upon you. In the mighty name of Jesus, God's grace be upon you. Hallelujah. God's grace be upon you. His favor, everything you touch, everywhere you go. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. God's grace be upon you. God's grace be upon you. I speak it on you, Miss T. God's grace be upon you, Miss Cassie. Hallelujah. And everything you do, everything you touch, everywhere you go. Favor. Favor. Somebody say, I'm favored by the Most High God. Come on and give him some glory. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Well, saints of God, it's so good to be in the house of the Lord today. Amen. Hallelujah, God. Glory to God. It's been a busy week. Amen. But he got us here. We here. You know what I'm saying? We here. We here Sunday. Amen. And we in the Lord's house. Glory to God. Just a few announcements. Amen. To get you going. Hallelujah. While you get yourself ready for the offering as well. Amen. Because we're about to do the offering. Hallelujah. I'm going to go through a few announcements while you get yourself ready. Hallelujah. Remember, the Lord's Supper is today. And so be asking the Lord, amen, for forgiveness of known and unknown sin. Amen. Also, be cognizant that the key of David is really, really getting moving. Amen. It's getting going. Hallelujah. And we're about to open it up to our brothers and sisters, our fellow Hebrews and Hebrew lovers on the outside. Had a business luncheon, amen, this week. And hallelujah, one of the attorneys in the city was so excited about the Key of David opportunity. And so you want to get in, amen, while you still can. I've ordered the membership cards. I'm going to pass them out probably next week and stuff like that, so you can begin to frequent those Hebrew businesses and get your discounts, amen. But also begin to spread the word to your friends and your family and maybe the Hebrew businesses, amen, that you, hallelujah, frequent. Because we're going to make this thing a citywide thing. We're going to make it a statewide thing. And with the help of the Most High God, we're going to make it a national thing, amen, to put us all on one accord. What could we do if we would just all just come together? Come on, somebody. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We also, amen, want to make available to you the list of Levitical clean and unclean foods. Amen. And so I spoke with Brian Noel, and we're going to try to do something to where we can put it out for you, where you can get it hard copy. Or maybe if you want to email, we can email it to you. Or maybe we can put it on the screen and you can take a shot of it. Amen. And once again, it's not to bind you, amen, so that you could try to be looking for salvation and you're refraining from crawfish. Now, salvation is in Christ, not crawfish, amen? All right? Hallelujah. But at the same time, you want to take care of the vessel that he gave you, amen? And we're going to feel better. We're going to look better, amen? With the grace of God, we're going to live longer, amen? Enjoy a better quality of life, amen? But it's all about what we put in this body that he gave us and blessed us with and our stewardship of it. And so if you got your phones, go ahead and snap your picture now. Amen. We're going to try our best to get a hard copy of that and maybe get that for you. Amen. Tuesday. Hallelujah. But this is very important, saints, because you are what you eat. Amen. And I wonder if we living at the bottom because all we eating is bottom dwellers. Amen. Oh, God, y'all don't want to start me today. Amen. And so, amen, let's just take a look at that and take that seriously, because it's instructions out of our Old Testament, how to get the most of out of our lives. Amen. Hallelujah. And so also put on that the clean and the unclean so that they can have both copies. Hallelujah. Thursday, amen, we're doing prayer, amen, and we'll have our new thing. We've been doing a meal after prayer because Thursday, amen, is our church fast day, and you can do whatever kind of fast you want, amen. This Thursday, I just went salad, amen. Next Thursday, I may go not eating, amen. But whatever you want to do, that's what you want to do. It's between you and the Lord. But what we want to do, we want to bless you so when you come on Thursday after prayer, we'll have a meal for you so you can break bread with us and eat. The fellowship was sweet on Thursday, and the spaghetti was off the chain. Amen? All right? Last Thursday, the church sponsored it. This Thursday, amen, we've been so graciously blessed to be sponsored. Our meal is sponsored by Robinson Investment Group, amen. And that's our very own, glory to God, our very own Benjamin Robinson, amen. He says he can handle all of your insurance, investments, and mortgage needs, amen. This brother, amen, his family, they really pressing after Christ, amen. And you don't meet too many good brothers like that. And when you meet one, amen, you want to keep him in your life, amen. and I done referred business to him already, and he's sponsoring, amen, our prayer meal, amen, Thursday evening. And if you're a business, or you have some business, amen, or you sell things and you need commissions, amen, we want to support you. You come on and contact, amen, my wife or one of the people in the Mills ministry, and you can be up here. I'm going to put you up there. Hallelujah for your business. Amen. And you're going to sponsor and support some food. Now, we don't want you to be cooking no stuff that's going to kill us. Amen. All right. And so most of the time when you sponsor, we will provide the meal. You just provide the l'argent. You understand what I'm saying? Can we be real? So that we can keep everything, amen, as healthy as we can, amen, as we grow in this area as well. Come on, give God some glory, amen. All right, just a couple of more, then we're going to go. Friday, our PCA Eagles basketball team, they made the playoffs, y'all. Come on, give God some glory. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And so the playoff game is this Friday at Progressive Baptist Church. What time, Deacon Coach Cardell? 7 o'clock? Amen. Hallelujah. So 7 o'clock at Progressive. Amen. We'd love if y'all all come and support. Amen. Our youngsters, our Eagles, as they soar for the Most High God. Amen. They got some stiff competition out there. But just like David in that valley, giants fall. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. All right, so after Friday, so you got Thursday meal in prayer, Friday game at Progressive, Saturday is the Marriage Ministry Fellowship at Oakbourne Country Club. Come on, give God some glory, amen. So if you want to sign up, just sign up in the foyer. It's going to cost a little something because we want to defray some costs from the church, amen. Hallelujah, and so, hallelujah, but for a meal and a time like we're going to have, amen, you're not going to find that any other place. And so, hallelujah, go in the foyer and they're going to tell you, by Miss Shalanda, amen. And I think it's like $10 or something like that for the ticket, amen. And you buy one for you and one for your wife, amen. But it's worth it. It's pouring into your marriage, and we're going to have a good time with a good program. So give God some glory, amen. That's this Saturday, so we'll sell the tickets all week long and also when we have Bible study on Tuesday. Glory to God. Let me see what else. Also, PCA is going to be in the foyer. Amen. We're taking our kids on a college tour of Spelman and Morehouse in Atlanta, Georgia. Amen. Hallelujah. And so it's a blessing, man. I'm telling you, I'm so excited about our school and our kids. Amen. Hallelujah. It's a miracle work. And so we're taking them, amen, to Atlanta to go get, hallelujah, acclimated with the university setting. Amen. If they never see it, they never going to do it. And so you want to bring them there to see it. Oh, I can do this. Amen. And so we bringing them. Hallelujah. Unfortunately, it costs a little money. Amen. And so they got a table out there. And if you want to donate anything on your way out, you can donate so that they can go on this trip. Amen. Every single dollar, quarter, or dime is going to help them get to Atlanta. Amen. And so... it's a good cause. If you got a little something extra, amen, just pass and throw it to them. It's going to be a blessing. Amen. All right, saints. All right. Officially, it's offering time. Come on. Hallelujah. Come on, ushers. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And so, saints, hallelujah, you know that God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. And we sung about his grace. He's been so good to us to give us what we don't deserve, to give him a little bit of money. Paper, construction paper, that's all it is nothing to us. You know what I'm saying? Me to give money means absolutely nothing to me. Because the same one that I'm giving it for, he's going to provide more in return. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. A lot of us hold too tightly to it. And the thing about holding on to it tightly, you can't receive if your fist is closed. Amen. You got to open and give, and it will be given unto you. Amen. And that's the way the cycle works. Amen. Hallelujah. And so saints, it's offering time. Amen. And we're going to put a little music on for you. And so let's go ahead and give unto the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. God bless y'all, saints, for being so giving. God bless you. God bless you. And if you're here and you want to give through the internet, you can do that at Expounding Truth Ministries or PCC, PhiladelphiaCC.org. You can also give on our giving phone number. You can actually text, amen, the number that's coming on the screen, amen. And you can text and give. It's very easy, amen. Once you got it set up, it'll be like a two-minute thing, amen. So we provided numerous amounts of ways whereby you can give. We don't care how you give, but we just ask that you do give, amen. Because sad to say, saints, the movement requires money. Don't you know that? Don't you know that? The movement requires money. Our problem so long is not that we have not had the heart to do things. We have not had the finances, the money, the administrative skills to do it. But I believe that the tides are changing. The season is changing. Amen. And both the money, the administrative and leadership know-how is going to be there, and the unity is going to be there. Amen. The movement is going to require money. Know that. So look in your life and understand your giftings, amen, and begin to put them to work for the Most High God. I don't care what you do. You bake pies, you make cold cups. Hallelujah. Give the Lord something that he can pour some money into you for the movement, amen. Everything that the movement requires, we will allow God to create it through us. If the movement requires music, PMG will give music for the movement. Hey, God. If the movement requires money, then we will work and labor that they can have money for the movement. If the movement requires pastors, we will raise up pastors, preachers, teachers, prophets, evangelists for the movement. Whatever the movement needs, hey, God. We are willing and waiting that God would provide it to us. So I need some people in here with some king's anointing, some business savvy, some inventions in their spirit to stand up and arise for the Most High God during this time. If any way we're going to get it, saints, we got to get it now. Amen. 400 years is over. It's our time. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Hey! Ushers, follow Minister Ann out. Amen. Glory to God. And if you missed the offering for some reason, amen, you can always give in the boxes in the back. Glory to God. On your way out or during the week if you want to stop by. Saints of God, we got a lot going on this morning. And so, hallelujah. I know it's rough for you, but we won't have a Hebrew nugget today. Amen. We got a lot of everybody. Oh, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Amen. It's a way to keep you hungry for them nuggets. Amen. Hallelujah. If you get them nuggets all the time, you won't be hungry for them nuggets. But we got the Lord's Supper, and I got a bunch of points this morning. So we're gonna follow the Spirit. Amen. We're gonna follow the Spirit. And so let's go ahead and open our Bibles up to the book of Acts, chapter 5, and verse 17, and we'll get cranked up, we'll get started. Hallelujah. So happy to be here with you this morning. We living in the most exciting time there is. I'm telling you, boy, listen. Woo! And I prayed. I said, Lord, hallelujah. You got Dr. King time and Abraham Lincoln time and Booker T. Washington time and all of these special times, Lord. And why am I born during this boring time? That's what I used to think. I used to think, Lord, I feel like I got more in me to woo, man, Lord, But Lord, have mercy. I believe this might be the greatest time in our history. You understand what I'm saying? Hey! And everybody that's here is born for such a time as this. Are you hearing me here? Are you hearing me up in here? For such a time as this. You were born for this movement. There is something in you that God needs, that God is going to use. You are going to play an important part in it. For a wheel that moves needs spokes. Oh, God. Hey! How many people willing to just be a spoke in the wheel? Just for the movement, just for the move. Make me a spoke in the wheel. Make me do what I gotta do. I'll stamp my widget. I'll cook this thing. I wherever place I gotta, every place, that part I gotta play. Yeah, whatever part I gotta play. I'ma play it. In the mighty name of Jesus. Let's look at Acts 5 and 17. The Bible says, then the high priest rose up. And all they that were with him, which is of the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation, and laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. But the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth and said, go, stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. We'll stop right there. Father, we pray that you add a blessing to the reading, the hearing, the exposition, the exegesis, God, and the proper execution of your word, O King. I pray that when I'm weak, you'd be strong, God. I pray that you give me wisdom, vision, that you'd open up the prophetic, God, and you would make plain and available the secrets of men's hearts, God. I pray that those that even came in with doubts, that they would say, truly, God is in this place, and we knew it not. I pray you bless it, and you release your anointing, for we know that it's the anointing that destroys the yokes. Every yoke be broken in here today. Every lie, God, every bondage, Lord God, everything that the devil is working in the people's lives, for we know, Christ, you came to destroy the works of the devil. So do it now for us, O King, O Christ, O Messiah, O Yahshua. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, give God some glory. Saints, last time I was up here, amen, we were in the book of Acts, amen, in chapter 5. And remember, Ananias and Sapphira were just smitten before the church because they had lied to God and lied to the Holy Ghost. And after, hallelujah, the Lord judged Ananias and Sapphira, amen, a great fear came upon all the church. And people didn't want to play with God anymore, amen. They took the things of God very seriously. Because of the great fear came a purity. Remember, people began to live for the Most High, hallelujah, with sincerity again. Well, anytime you got the fear of God and purity, another result of that is going to be power. Because God is always looking for a vessel, amen, that's pure. Always looking for a vessel, amen, that'll keep themselves, amen. Hallelujah. The Bible says it like this in the Pauline epistles, that God is looking for a vessel that's meet for the master's use, amen. And you can be a vessel of honor or you can be a vessel of dishonor. Well, the early church in Acts decided, they made a conscious decision to fear God and to be pure. And what God did in response is what God will do for every single one of us if we would take the things of God serious. He pours his power in. He pours his anointing in. He pours his extraordinary, hallelujah, movement in. And that's when the power came, saints. And we saw signs and wonders and miracles, amen, being wrought by the hands of the apostles. And I'm believing that we're living in a day, if we would just fear God again, reverence him and take him seriously and do our best. Now, I know we won't be perfect, but if we strive for perfection, you understand what I'm saying? If we press towards the mark, amen, God's going to pour in his anointing. And he's going to take the ordinary and he's going to make it extraordinary. Amen. And that's where I want to live. I don't want to live in the mediocre. I don't want to live in the average. I don't want to live in what I can do. I want to live in what God can do. Amen. I want a church that can only be when God is being and doing in it. Amen. I don't want Philly to reflect my knowledge, my wisdom. No. We don't want that. I don't want all of our businesses, saints, to reflect our knowledge and our wisdom. No. We praying for the X factor. We praying for the Christ factor. We praying for the God factor to be in everything that we do. Well, the early church was operating in this next level blessing. But anytime you have fear, purity, and power, amen, to borrow from an old hymn writer, the haters don't like that. Amen? All right? The haters don't like that. And so we talked about the haters. And we started a series on persecution. And for the first point, we talked about the persecution rose up. And I just talked about the pure and the powerful being persecuted. The Bible says all that will live godly will suffer persecution. Secondly, we focused in upon who were, amen, the parties that persecuted the people of God. And it was the high priest and the Sadducees. And we looked at that and we just, hallelujah, zeroed in that most persecution will come from the religious. Those that don't have a real relationship with God, they will be jealous of your relationship with God, amen, because they are in religion. And that's where persecution comes from. Thirdly, we talked about the indignation that was in the religious hearts. They persecuted primarily, hallelujah, because they were motivated by envy and jealousy, amen, because of the power, the popularity, the blessings, amen, that was on the early church. Saints of God, we pick up this morning in verse 18, and we'll continue this series of persecution, amen. I believe we're on persecution, either part 4 or part 5, I don't know, but wherever we are is persecution. Amen. And we're gonna roll like that. Yeah, part 4. Thank you, Brent, for helping me out here. So I won't put the points up because we got a lot. I'm going to just tell you we got several points. Amen. And I'm going to stop at a certain time. And so when that time comes, we're going to stop because we have the Lord's Supper. But let's begin with the first point, laid their hands. And in 5:18, the Bible says, talking about the high priest and the Sadducees, and they laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. Saints of God, the high priest and the Sadducees, being filled with jealousy, persecuted the early church. And verse 18 tells us how they persecuted them. The Bible says they laid hands on them. Now, this does not mean that they prayed for them, saints. They didn't lay them kind of hands on them. But they laid them hands that y'all used to lay. Destiny, you used to lay them hands on people? Hallelujah. Where my sister at? Oh, she not? Okay, second sir. Got a few people that used to lay hands. They talking about laying hands. That's the kind of hands they laid on the apostles. Amen. And what I mean by that is they physically restrained them, took them into custody. They arrested them. And remember, this is the second time that Peter and John was arrested. If you remember in Acts chapter 4, they were arrested the first time for healing the man at the beautiful gate. They arrested them there. You see? But this time is going to be a little different, and we'll talk about the difference in point number 2. The revelation in point number 1 is this, that when you're operating in purity, power, the extraordinary, the favor of God, and people beginning to be saved and touched by your ministry or your business, people beginning to change, amen, people going to try to persecute you. Yeah. And the Bible tells us how they will try to persecute you. They will try their best to lay hands on you. Yeah. Oh, you got to feel me up in him. What you mean by that, Pastor? They will try to hurt you if they can. They will try to harm you if they can. In some kind of way, whatever they can get away with, they're going to do it. That's why in other countries like hallelujah, the radical Islamic countries, amen, they'll put them in prison. They'll beat them with rods. They'll physically harm them. Your purity, your godly life, and your favor in the wrong circumstance can make people want to physically hurt you or harm you. Anybody hear me up in here? Now, that's not happening yet in America, but we got to be resolved that, come with me, we're not letting go of Jesus, amen? Hey, like they say, come hell or high water, amen? You got to be settled in your heart that they could take away everything from you, but they will never be able to take away Yahshua Jesus Christ, amen? And that's the thing, T, that make them most upset. Because after they cut them boys' arms off and they whip them and they beat them and everything like that, them boys still singing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. You see, they will try to hurt you, harm you, lay hands on you. But even going into it in a spiritual sense, I love the way the new translators translate this word, hallelujah, to lay hands upon. They translated arrest, and the NLT says they arrested the apostles. Somebody say arrested. This word arrested dropped a revelation upon me. And the revelation is that the haters and the devils if they can't physically hurt you, they gonna try to arrest you. All right? All right? All right? Pastor, what you mean by arrest you? Well, the definition of arrest is simple. Arrest means to seize. It means to stop. It means to halt. It means to check, to block, to hinder, to restrict, to limit, to inhibit, to impede, to curb. Now listen to me good, saints. You fear God. The power of God is operating in your life. You being blessed in the city, blessed in the field. You doing extraordinary things and people watching you and things happening to you that your education can't, hallelujah, validate. God has set before you an open door. Them haters don't like that. And if they can't hurt you, they're going to try to arrest you. They're going to try to stop you, halt you, seize you, curb you, limit you, inhibit the things that God want to do through you. So you got to know that. You got to know that. Amen. You got to know that they're going to try to arrest, hallelujah, your progress. And you got to have knowledge of that. They will always try to stop the thing that God is trying to do through you. All right? It's one of the tactics of the adversary. Be aware and be careful. Pastor, why are you telling us that? Well, because, hallelujah, you're about to get on the move, saints. You're about to get on the move, saints. Where you are right now, you cannot stay. Hey, God, he moving stuff out the nest. He's about to make you take flight. He's about to make you take flight. But I want to prophetically warn you that once you spread your wings, that there will be some that'll try to arrest your development, that'll try to seize your progress, that'll try to halt your ascent in the Most High God. And if you don't know that, that lack of knowledge will hurt you. So people are going to run interference so that you can take your eyes off the plow, take your hands off the plow. For he that regarded the clouds never plowed. You understand what I'm saying? It was only when Peter, hey God, began to look at the waves and the wind and the storm that he ceased walking on water. I'm about to teach you how to walk on water. In your area, you're about to walk on water, but you cannot allow people to arrest you. Oh God, have mercy. Yeah. The devil's going to try to do it. He's going to try to do it the same way he did when Jesus was on his ascent to Calvary to do his work and his plan. He was speaking through people in the closest circle of Jesus. Peter himself speaking out of his mouth. Lord, not you, not Lord, trying to arrest the progress. Can you hear when people around you trying to arrest your progress? Can you hear it? Can you hear the fork-tongued devil speaking through even the people you love? Might even be saved folk in the church. You got a dream, but they're saying it's never going to happen. You got a vision. You got something that you, hey, God. And they running interference. You see? That's what the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the high priesthood was doing. They took them, laid hold on them. But the laying hold, the harm, the arrest was for them to stop doing what God wanted them to do. What I'm preaching to you about is to have grit and tenacity. And once you have it from God, lock onto it like a pit bull. You understand what I'm saying? And you say, I'm not going to let this go. Let God go. Tell he bless me. I don't care what the wife doing. I don't care what the husband doing. I don't care what the kids doing. I don't care what my mom and my daddy say. I don't care what they saying. Amen. I'm not going to let them arrest my progress. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. As I think of Nehemiah, that's the same thing happened to Nehemiah. He on the wall building the wall. And they keep coming to Nehemiah. Nehemiah, come off the wall. I'm not coming off the wall, Nehemiah said. I've got work to do. How many people got work to do for the Lord? Anybody got work to do for the Lord? Why are you allowing people to get you off the wall? You coming down off the wall to fuss with people in the mud. You know what I'm saying? You coming down off the wall. I'm going to tell her a piece of my mind. Don't tell her a piece of your mind. You're trying to tell her a piece of your mind when you could be working on a piece of this wall. What is wrong with you? Stop playing in the mud. Me and my wife talk about it all the time. Children play in the mud. Adults don't play in the mud. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I did as a child. But when I became a man, I'm looking for a man of God. I'm looking for a woman of God that's going to say, I'm not coming down to play with you in the mud. I got work to do. The movement requires some things that God has sown in me, and I can't come down to play. I can't come down to play with you. So whatever you talk about, keep talking about it. Whatever you're doing, keep doing it. You do you, and I'm going to do him. And they will try to arrest your progress. All right? Spot them out. And don't come down. Listen, our teachers watch the kids play at school. You understand what I'm saying? But we ain't going to roll around the concrete with them. Some of y'all playing with the kids. And that's why the work not being done. My grandpa always used to say, we say, Papa, such and such. He said, no. He'd be real French. No, no, no. I got work to do. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Second point, the common prison. The common prison. The Bible says, and they laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. The Bible tells us where they put the apostles once they laid hands on them. The Bible says they put them in the common prison. The modern translations say that they put them in the public jail, the public prison, you know. This to me was different than when John and Peter was arrested the first time. If we look at it in Acts chapter 4, verse 3 to be exact, the Bible says that they laid hands on them and put them in hold until the next day, for it was now evening time. You see, the first time they arrested them, they put them in hold. The Greek word right there gives the illusion as though they put them in their own little private cell, heaven. You know what I'm saying? They didn't put them with the rest of the population. You know what I'm saying? They put them in their own little private cell, and they were there waiting, amen, until they would have their, I guess, what you would call it, the 72-hour hearing, amen, that we normally have in our court system. And so they were waiting. Amen. They put them in hold. But right here in our text in Acts chapter 5, there's a difference here. And Luke could have used the same word. They arrested them, they laid hands on them, and they put them in hold again. But he didn't say that, G Money. He didn't say they put them in hold again. He says they arrested them this time, but they put them in the public, and King James says the common jail. What does that mean? And why is that so significant? Well, the common jail, amen, is when they put the apostles, the ones who had been with Jesus, the one who had been with the God, the creator of the heavens and the earth. They touched him. They handled him. They ate with him. He anointed them. He filled them up with the Spirit. They laid hands. They healed folk. They spoke healing. The shadow of them boys would heal people. They took the messengers, the apostles, of the Most High God. The ones that he had chosen for that time to be dispensers of the new covenant. Oh, God, have mercy. There's no more important job on the face of the planet at that time for the Most High God. There's not another person that should be more consecrated and respected and set apart than these apostles right here. He's the one that they were, that he was, they're the ones that he was moving through during that age, during that generation. And they took them, the apostles, and put them in the common prison with the rest of the thieves, the murderers, the rapists, with the worst sorts of people. They put them in the common, the public prison. You see? Kind of reminds me of what they did to Jesus when they crucified him. He was numbered with transgressors. We see here a mode of operation of Satan. I told you what they did to persecute them, but now we're going to look more particular, amen, about their motive for persecution right here. You see, because to put them in the common prison had a motive. You see, what was that motive? That motive was to take something that God has made extraordinary and to make it ordinary. Their purpose was to take something that God, hallelujah, has set apart for himself and to make it common. Their purpose was to take something that was building a godly reputation, a reputation that the people on the outside were looking towards and highly esteeming. And their purpose was to lower that reputation and make them less esteemed. Ordinary, not extraordinary, and common, amen, and not set apart from God. You see, Satan and the persecutors and the haters, hey God, if they can't hurt you physically, if they can't stop your development, hey, God, they're going to try to ruin your reputation. Hey! They'll try to make sure that everybody knows there's nothing special about you. That you're ordinary. That you're nothing. That you're common. They put them in the common prison. And that's what Satan does. That's what he does. They treated Jesus like he was common. The Most High, the most anointed. You know what I'm saying? They say he the prince of the devils. They say he gluttonous and he demon possessed. They try to put their mouth on him to take away the extraordinary. They not only did it to Jesus, they did it to Joseph. By throwing him in the pit, selling him into slavery. They not only did it to Jesus and Joseph, they did it to Daniel. Taking him, throwing him in the lion's den. You ain't nothing, he ain't nothing. When he was extraordinary, they did it to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who were extraordinary in Babylon at that time. They ain't nothing. Throw him in the fiery furnace. And they do it here to the apostles. And they not only did it to Jesus and Joseph and Daniel and the apostles, they did it to the real Hebrews from a historical sense. They ain't nothing. Throw them in slavery. Put them in the projects. Put them on food stamp. They ain't nothing. Because the devil always seeks to take that which God esteems and to defile it. Hey, and to pervert it. It's his rationale. Whatever God esteems and loves, he wants to take it and make it common and drag it in the mud. Listen to me, this is true for your life. You got extraordinary on the inside of you. But you've been allowing the devil to make you common. You got potential that's divine. You see? But you've been allowing them haters, hey God, to put you in the public jail. And sometimes we can't control where our persecutors put us. But you could control who you are on the inside. Just because they put me in a cage don't make me an animal. Just because they treat me as common don't mean that I got to believe that I'm common. I'm not common. I'm not common. I'm a chosen generation. I'm a royal priesthood. I'm a peculiar people. I've been set apart for the Most High's work. Hey! That's the thing that the devil seeks to do. He put them in the common prison. And you got to realize that as God begins to do extraordinary things through you, that the haters going to put their mouth on you. They're going to talk about you. They're going to gossip about you. Oh, that's just this, that's just that, that's something. There ain't nothing special about them. They still the same old, same old. You know? But I got a question for you. Whose report shall you believe? My God say, hey, that you the apple of his eye. That's what my God says. You see? And you got to believe God. They put them in the common prison. They're going to try to lump you together with all manner of different people, the worst sorts of people. And by God, if you make errors and mistakes or if you have shortcomings, oh, your haters will magnify your shortcomings. They're not going to magnify God. They're going to magnify your shortcomings. Meaning they're going to take that little thing you do wrong and put it under a microscope. You understand what I'm saying? And dissect what you do wrong. Amen. All in an attempt to ruin your reputation, to ruin your esteem, to make you common. Amen. When God said you're not common. When God said you're not common. Oh, I'm preaching to somebody and I'm telling you. We got to be careful of this. Be aware that people are going to try to tarnish your reputation. And so what does that do? Listen, be on guard. Live the best life you can. Don't be making all kind of errors, shortcomings, sin. Because as soon as you do it, amen, the devil going to put it on the billboard. You got to understand what I'm saying. His reputation is what, your reputation is what he's after. You see what I'm saying? Really, God and the devil after your reputation. God is after it because he's going to put it on a candlestick and put it up so that he can let it shine for the whole world to see what a man looked like that give himself over to God. But the devil after your reputation to take it, run it through the mud and put your shortcomings on blast so that like he did with David, they might blaspheme the name of the Most High God. So you have a choice of who you're going to give your reputation this morning. And my vote for us as a church is that we would give our reputation to God. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Secondly, don't hang around people, amen, that's trying to tarnish somebody else's reputation. In your eyes, before you got with these people, amen, you notice the work of God in that person you love. You notice that they were doing extraordinary things. But when you get around these certain people, they put their mouth on the vessel of God that you love, amen, and you begin to look at them as common. They done tarnish your view, your perception. Now, the person has never changed, but your perception has changed. And that's a dangerous thing. Why? Well, I'm trying to tell you something. Listen, when they put them in the common in the public jail, amen, this was so everybody in Jerusalem could see it. Because they kept themselves high priests, Pharisees. We the untouchables. We higher than everybody else. We separate than everybody else. And look at who y'all following. They in the common jail. They dirty. They unclean. They were trying to send a public message, you see, trying to get the public to realize that's common people. We better go back to following the Sadducees and the high priests and everybody. These common folk, Peter and John and Paul, not Paul, Peter and John and them boys. Pastor, what you preaching about? I'm preaching that people will get in your ear and make the uncommon common. Make the uncommon common. And you can have somebody that God is moving through on your job, in your life, in your church, in your family, in your community, in your city, in your nation, in your generation, in your time. They moving and they walking right with you. Extraordinary, but you treating them like common. Man, that was the MO. We're going to get them to treat the apostles common. What's the word, Pastor? Watch who in your ear. Watch who in your ear. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. A whisperer separated chief friend. You see what I'm saying? You see? And the funny thing about it is them people that's whispering in your ear can't do nothing for you. The extraordinary people that God placed around you in your life, and there's more than one, there's a bunch of them. They are the ones that God had sent to help you. But you allow the haters and the ones that's possessed by the devil to tarnish, to make common. Now the people sent to help you, you're looking at them like they can't help themselves. And the people that's in your ear, they can't do nothing for you. They put them in the common prison. Point number three. But the angel of the Lord. I love this part of the Bible. Anytime you got that but God, that but the angel of the Lord, you know what I'm saying? That's when we're about to have a transition. You see what I'm saying? Y'all still up out there? All right? The Bible says in 19, but the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth. The Bible says that after the leaders and the haters laid hands on them, put them in the common prison, tried to ruin their reputation, tried to ruin their ministry. The Bible says after all that, the angel of the Lord. Somebody say the angel of the Lord. Yeah. That's what the Bible says. Now, the first revelation that I have is this, all right? Think about the timing that the angel of the Lord showed up. He showed up after they laid hands on him. He showed up after they put him in the common prison. He showed up after they ruined their reputation. He showed up after, amen, after they made him common. Now, I love this. Don't you think that God could have made the angel show up before all of that? Hey! What does that teach us? That a lot of times God will allow a setback for a setup. Anybody hear me up in here? Anybody hear me up in here? That what the devil meant for bad, God gonna work it out for good. Yeah, they try to hurt you, talk about you, throw you under the bus. That's gravy, that's good. Because God going to use that very thing to exalt you. He going to allow your enemies to be your footstool. He going to raise you up higher. Hey! Through the people that try to hurt you. The angel of the Lord came after the drama. He came after the mess. The angel come after the bankruptcy, after the divorce, after the sickness, after. He came after. Sometimes we going through, Lord, where you at? Hold on. I'm coming after. Because if I stop it, hey, God, I can get this glory. But if I let you go through the mess, if I let you, hey, I'll be able to get this amount of glory. That's why the Bible tells us, count it all joy. Because the Lord is working even through our mess, even through our prison, even through our sentence, even through our sickness, even through the divorce, even through the rain. Hey! Bible says, but the angel of the Lord came by night when it was dark, when all hope was gone, when it looked like your enemies had won. Hey! Hey! When it looked like they're going to have the last laugh. When it looked like your reputation is ruined. When it looked like God can't use you no more. When you look like Samson in the Philistine dungeon with your head cut off and your eyes put out. But the angel of the Lord. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome? We serve a fourth quarter comeback type of a God. We serve a God that'll come after you get knocked down. You hear me? And that ball standing over you counting. One, two. You understand what I'm saying? And God might not show up one day on the ones and the twos. He might not show up when they're on the four and the five. But oh, when they get to eight and the nine. Hey! God's standing there waiting. They saying eight, nine, nine and a quarter, nine and a half, nine and three quarters, nine and seven, eight. But the angel of the Lord. Hey! Come on, somebody. That tells me we might be down, but we never out. Hey! For the righteous man falleth seven times, but he get back up. It ain't over till God says it's over. Hey! He came after your mess. After you thought you was ruined. You don't think that he could have come before the Samaritan woman, the woman at the well, before she married five and got six and seven and 800? You don't think he could have showed up, amen, and healed the blind man who was born blind when he was three or four? You don't think he could have showed up when the lame man who was born lame was 20 and 17? No, 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 no. He wanted to show that miracles happen after 40. The angel of the Lord came by night. He liked to come in the night. He liked to tell you, weeping may endure for a... But when I'm done with this night, when I'm done with this night, after this night, what's going to happen tonight, in the night? Joy is going to come in the morning. Listen, man, never count God out. Never count God out. Boys thought they had won, man. They thought they had won. We got them. We've ruined them. They common. They unclean. They're not separate no more. We put them in the common prison. We put them in the public jail. But the angel of the Lord showed up. And the Bible says in the next point here, what the angel did. He opened the prison doors. Anybody like open doors up in here? Anybody like open doors up in here? Listen to me good, Philadelphia. We got to focus on what he did. The angel just didn't show up, but he did something. He opened the doors. And in Revelations 3 and 7, which is the message to the church of Philadelphia, which is our vision, which is our message, which is our church that we managing for the Most High God. He tells us, and to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things said he that is holy, he that is true, he that had the key of David, he that opened it, and no man shut it, and no man opened it. He said, I know thy works. Behold, open your eyes, regard and see. I have set before thee an open door. Hey, and no man can shut it. Listen, listen, listen. The angel opened the doors. The persecutors closed the doors. The persecutors locked the doors. The persecutors put them behind doors with bars that could not be opened. But when the persecutors closed and locked the doors, God opened the doors. And that ministered to me. that ministered to me. Whatever the jealous do, whatever the haters do, whatever the persecutors do, whatever the devils do in your life, God is able to undo what they do and work it together for your good. My Bible says it like this: no weapon formed against you shall prosper. My Bible says it like this: every tongue that rises up against you shall be condemned. My Bible says a thousand will fall at this side, 10,000 at that side, but it shall not come nigh thee. My Bible tells me, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. They can close the door on me, but you're with me in the door that's closed. And when you decide, you can open. You can open the door. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord will lift up a standard against him. And just don't quote these things. Write them on the pages of your heart and live by them. Remember them. I'm not quoting cliches. I'm quoting life scriptures. Because the same one that can quote it won't live it. The same one that can quote it don't believe it. But when you believe that no matter how many come against you, hey, when my enemy came against me, they stumbled and fell. Though a host should encamp against me, even in this shall I be confident. Do you believe those scriptures? Can you walk out just with God? Hey, and the world is against you, and you still be courageous and full of faith and victorious. You walk up wherever arena God wants you in. Whether it's the courtroom, whether it's the executive business room, whether it's the interview room, you can walk in there anywhere believing, though a host, even in this shall I be confident. Do you say that? Or do you believe that? You see? What you need to understand, Christian, is that you a winner. You a winner, man. You're not no loser. You a winner. Pastor, why I'm a winner? Because Christ done already won the victory. You a winner. It don't mean that you're not going to have tough times every now and then. But in the end, we win. Some of y'all going out there, y'all got a loser mentality. In your mind, you already setting up not getting the job. In your mind, you already setting up not receiving the blessing. The problem is, as a man thinketh, so is he. Remember what Brother Doug taught us, amen, last Sunday. When God heard what was coming out of our mouth, he gave us what we said. That's why we got to speak life. But the only way to speak life is to think life. Oh, come on, somebody. The angel opened the doors. He opened the doors. You see? He opened the doors. Listen, listen. It's going to be a revelation. The people of God will come out on top. They will come out on top. All right? And the haters and persecutors will come out on the bottom. This is in every sector of life. I'm talking about governments, nations, and I'm talking about little beef between people. In every situation, if you watch it closely, you will see the hand of God make his people, the ones that he with, come out on top. And the ones that's against his people, they will come out on the bottom. I've been at this for a little while now. And I have watched, amen, the people of God, and I have watched the haters. And I always tell my wife, I got a phrase around the house. I say, let's see how this thing turned out. Let's give it a little bit of time. You see, when you on God's side, no matter what they try to do to you, no matter what they try to say about you, no matter how they try to arrest you and lock you up, if you just keep serving God, God will send an angel and the angel will open the door. Meaning that you gonna come out on top, but I hadn't really talked about your enemies, the one who put you in there. They gonna come out on the bottom. The ones that threw Daniel in the lion's den was thrown in the lion's den. The very ones that tried to throw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, they the ones that got burnt up. Anybody hear me up in here? They threw Joseph into slavery, but Joseph sat in the seat of authority, and they had to come beg Joseph for some bread. You gotta watch the workings of providence. When you learn how to discern providence, you're gonna know who God with. All right? You say, but Pastor, wait, didn't they crucify Jesus? Yeah, but he rose on the third day. And he's seated at the right hand of glory, above every principality and power and ruler and dominion, and he warned them, boy. He said, from henceforth, you're going to see the man coming with the cloud, with the power and majesty. That's what you're going to see. When you're on God's side, it's going to work out for your good. Hey! Hey! My enemies come up against me. They stumble and fail. Watch the ones that come up against you. Watch the ones that come up against church leadership and pastor. Watch them. Just sit back and watch. Don't get involved. Just watch. Settle in your heart, I'm not going to pick a side till the dispensation has been dealt. He who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. The angel opened the doors. Not gonna let them hold you, dog. You know? I believe that God is opening some doors for people in 2017. I really believe that. I really believe that. Amen. And I love the way it's just not doors, Sabrina. He says he opened the He opened the prison doors. The door that was supposed to stay shut. The place where you were supposed to stay. You were supposed to rot there and die there. It was a prison door. It was meant to keep you at a certain place. We got doors that's been closed on us, that's been strategically placed by the adversary and his people to keep us someplace. And a prison door ain't got that little screen door lock on it. It's got deadbolts on it, because what's ever in there should die in there. But I love that my God can open prison doors. Huh, Misha? Huh, Chance? Huh, Miss Karen? Mel? Prison doors. Places where you were supposed to stay. You were supposed to stay in the project. Huh, Billy Clay? You were supposed to stay there. Huh? Not where you're living, baby. Not what you're doing, baby. Huh? You were supposed to stay with that conviction record on you. You were supposed to stay, you know what I'm saying, in the club. And you were supposed to stay as a people You know what I'm saying? Just stay low with nothing, having nothing, knowing nothing. You were supposed to stay there. It was a prison door that was put on you and closed shut. The way was shut. It was intentional. But I'm glad this morning. I'm glad this morning. No matter what the devil sold in your life through your mama, your daddy, your uncle, the prison door they put on you, the way they molested you, the way they abused you, the way they spoke over you, the way they, hey, God, I'm so glad this morning that whatever door they put upon you, the Lord will send his angel to open, to open, to open the prison doors. I've had prison doors open in my life. Had them open. You know? I've had them open. And you began to see the world differently. You see? What we learn in the legal field, amen, is that sometimes people can get out of prison, but still have a prison mentality. Meaning you could take the Negro out the hood, but you can't take the hood out the Negro. And that's why I love the next point that we have this morning. It ministered to me so much. He not only sent the angel not only opened the prison doors, but the angel went another extra mile and brought them forth. Oh, somebody feeling me already. You see, this is amazing, saints. Because some people have the open door and don't know it. They standing behind a door that's closed, but it's unlocked. It's really an open door. All they got to do is push it and walk through it. Anybody hear me up in here? Hey! And that's us right now. That's Philadelphia right now. That's the Hebrews right now. The door is open. But the problem is, if you've been in prison so long, the door could be open, but you won't know what to do with an open door. You, the door open, you just looking at it. I was a dog kind of strange. All right? He a strange character. All right? Now, I was feeding him yesterday. All right? I'll feed him dog food. Now, the kids in the kitchen, and they eating good, you know, nice food on the table that he would really like, all right? I opened the door. You see what I'm saying? The vision just came to me. I opened the door, and you know what Barack does when I open the door. He run up to the door. He looked through the door, but he never walked past the door. He never come in. Now. Everything that you could want is past that threshold. They got blessings in here that you can't even conceive. But you're so used to being outside. You're so used to being locked up in the kennel. You're so that you have an open door but won't walk through. Watch me, Brother Doug. They got open doors for future business owners. Open doors for investors. Open doors for inventors. Open doors for ministry and future pastors and prophets and evangelists. Open doors for future first ladies. Open doors for singles. Open doors for marriages. Open doors for our children. The doors are open and the possibilities are endless. But what we have here is a people that can see the open door but won't walk through it. I'm telling you. That's why some of the other nations look at the so-called African America and don't give us no respect. Because the opportunity is there. The possibility is there. The probability is there. But the ability is lacking. Hey! Oh, come on, just stay with me. Y'all not sleeping up in here, huh? The angel not only opened the door, but thanks be to God. When we don't know exactly what to do with an open door, when after the angel opened the door, we just look how pretty that is, isn't that? We rather look at the other side, talk about the other side, meet, smoke a little herb while we play the PlayStation and talk about what we could do if we had $1 million and what we would do. We look through the door, but ain't nobody ever walked through the door. Now, this is how good God is. He know his people. And sometimes if you won't go through, he'll not only open the door, but he'll send his angel, hey, to bring you through. Come on in here. Come on in here. Come on in here. Somebody say, Lord, send me an angel. Oh, that's what I'm talking about. Hey! Listen. The angel brought them forth. You don't know what to do with an open door? I'm going to start you off. You walk through an open door. You get over to the other side. Listen to me, man. Some of you are still in the same situation you was in last year. And maybe even in a worse situation than that. Listen to me while I speak to your life. I know you come to church, you act the big time and all that. You in the same situation. There's no progress. You driving the same thing, living the same place, making the same wage. No inventions, no business opportunities, nothing. You're just there. You never even rose up in ministry. You're in the same place. We call that stagnation. When water sit. We were never meant to sit. We were meant to grow. Glory to glory. Faith to faith. Strength to strength. The people that know their God shall do great exploits. But you sitting, looking at the open door. Oh, it's so nice out there. Beyond that threshold is great. And you can draw it, you can talk about it, but you ain't never been there. I want to challenge you this year. Walk through. Walk through. Walk through. Do something. Try something. Let me tell you the greatest threat to the open door. Let me tell you what it is. Some of y'all can guess. Let me tell you what it is. Let me tell you what Barack, my dog, the reason he stands at the threshold. Fear. Fear. He don't know what's in there. He don't know what's in there. He don't know what it's going to be like. And so he would rather stay in his current condition. When there's endless possibilities right around the bend, he would rather stay where he at and suffer in the status quo than just open the door, which is already open, and just walk through to another level. Fear. Let me tell you something else about fear. For God had not given us a spirit of fear. It come from the devil. And the ones that act the most spiritual, when you break it down, you look at their life and what they do, sometimes be the most fearful. Most fearful. Can't do nothing. Can't try nothing new. Jump, man. Jump, man. Jump. Get in the water, man. I can't swim. You're not going to learn how to swim until you... What, you going to learn how to swim on land? What is wrong with you? Don't be no coward, man. The righteous are as bold as lion. You scared of nothing, man. We can lose. We can't lose. Lose what? Lose what? Brought them forth. You see? I have in my notes, you have all the tools and still not successful. You got all the raw materials, but still broke. You have the open door, but you're still behind it. The Lord gave me a word, look for your angel. Look for your angel. God gonna send you an angel. That's how merciful and gracious he is. He not only gonna open it, but he gonna give us somebody to walk us through that open door with us. He gonna give it to us. And I don't know who it is in your life. Hey, could be a mama, could be a daddy, could be a sister, could be a brother, could be a deacon, could be a minister, could be your pastor, could be a stranger, because you got to be careful to entertain strangers, but some have entertained angels unawares. But no matter who it is, you need to say, Lord, send me an angel. Yeah. They're going to help you walk through. Bring you places you ain't never been before. You see? And I believe that God is growing up within Philadelphia. And don't get all theological on me here. You know I know what an angel is. But for mere symbolism, I believe that God is raising up in Philadelphia a group of angels. Hey! That's going to be able to help people through the open door. Help bring you to the next level. Help get you where you want to be. You can't go because you ain't never been that way before. It was like the children of Israel. They had never been that way before. He had to send his angel, the pillar of cloud by day, the pillar of fire by night. Listen. I believe he's raising up in Philly a group of people that's doing things, some leaders, some king's anointings, amen. And we're going to help one another. Because some of y'all got all the raw materials, but you ain't done nothing. You ain't been nowhere. He's going to raise up angels in our midst. Yeah, that business can work. Yeah, you could be a millionaire. Yeah, you could be successful. Oh, but I'm scared. Don't be scared. Fear not, I am with thee. Huh, you understand what I'm saying? Y'all all right out there? Yeah. Somebody say, Lord, send me an angel. Now remember, humble yourself. Because he could send you an angel, but if you're full of pride, you ain't going to follow that angel. You sit there in the cell, the angel like, come on, man. I'm trying to bring you to the next level. Oh, but I know the next level better. You ain't ever been to the next level. You heard about it. You saw the picture of it. You could describe it. But I have been there, the angel going to say. Marriages, business, children, music, inventions. The list can go on and on. We could be the greatest ministry in the nation if we see the open door and allow the angels to bring us through. Last point. Go, stand, and speak. After the haters lay hands on you, try to hurt you, harm you, put you in the common prison, and the angel of the Lord show up and make you stronger than before they lay their hands on you. Make you more anointed, amen, than when they touch you. Solidify you more than when they tried to take you down. Hey, God, now you come out of that. Hallelujah. They tried to urge, they put you in common prison. Now you come out with a testimony. I done seen his angel. The angel not only show up, but the angel opened the door for you. He not only opened the door for you, but he bring you forth through the door into your calling, into your divine destiny. After you get to that place, now what? The angel say, go, stand, and speak. That's what the angel say. I love this. Go. All right? Go. I mean, don't stay in the prison. Don't stay around the prison. You know? Don't stay in a comfortable place. No, go. It's an action word. Go. All right? Go to the same place that you came out of to help somebody else. Go. I love this when it comes down to the church. Don't stay in here with all the word. Go out there and spread some word. Go. He said go. Then he says stand. I always heard if you don't stand for something, you're going to fall for everything. We got a Christian church that's not standing. We go, we get there, but we don't stand up for nothing. When you go, stand up for Jesus. Stand up for the word. Stand up for Christianity. Don't run. Stand your ground. This is what I believe. This is what God has done for me. And I'm not changing that. He said, go, stand. Then he says, speak. Open your mouth. Let the people know what God brought you out of. What he's done for you. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. I tell you this because right now, amen, you in transition. You moving through the door and the business is about to be birthed. But this is a future prophetic word. Because after you get it, after you arrive, after you get the business, the house, the marriage, after you go and you put that fear down and you get all that God has for you, the message is now go for God, stand for God, speak for God. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Yeah. We don't say nothing. Nobody else will. We got to open our mouths, y'all. We got to open our mouths, you know. And then he says, not only speak, and we winding down. He says in that same verse, he tells us what to speak. Speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. Because while you're speaking and you're testifying from where God brought you from to where you are now, can you see yourself in that place? Because that's where you're going. As you testify to people, amen, the journey that God brought you on, you know, don't ever forget to include in that message all the words of this life. What life? That's a deep question. You got to tell them about this life. On earth right now. The life without God. You got to tell them how empty it is. how vain it is, how unsatisfying this life is. You got to tell them that we just living to die in this regular life without God. But at the same time, we are dying to live. I've been there before. Had all the parties, all of this, that, and all that. Listen, I done been on both sides, the educational heights and the street heights. And everywhere you look for life, it's not there. It's not there. It's not there. Tell them about this life. Tell them about it. That all we do in this life, hallelujah, is sin against a holy God. And the wages of sin is that. Tell them about this life. Then tell them about this life. This life in Christ. What kind of life is it, Pastor? It's an abundant life. That word abundant means full, overflowing. When I compare my life to before Christ to my life to after Christ, there's no comparison. I'm telling you, not for one second do I want to go back to the world. Not for one second I want to go back to what I was doing. It don't matter what drink, what drug, what club, what woman, what party. It don't matter. It is not as abundant to how we living right now. Who agree with me up in here? Who agree with me up in here? You tell them about this life, because on TV and in the world, they try to make their life look so good. But you don't see the pills and the drugs and the STDs. You don't see the suicides. You don't see the broken homes. You don't see, they don't show none of that on TV. They just show them smiling and going in the bedroom. They don't show them at the clinic. Anybody hear me up in here? You tell them about this life, not the life on Facebook. Not the fake life we put the pictures we want that we don't look like no more. Not that life. That's fake life. You tell them, don't live a Facebook life. Live a faith in Christ life. That's real life. I ain't got to show you no pictures. You tell them all the words of this life. The abundant life, peace that passeth understanding, joy unspeakable and full of glory. You see? You tell them all the words of this life, because after this abundant life, you tell them we receive everlasting life. You see? They dying to live out there. We living, and we're going to continue to live. Even when we die, we live on. For the Christian, death is a transition. It's just a shadow that passes over us. It's just a short nap. It's a blink of our eyes, and it's an open. You see? And that life dies and goes to eternal death. This life lives and goes to eternal life. We've been promised an endless life because we have a living hope in Christ. And as you go stand and speak, you tell them all of this. You tell them of the hopelessness of what the world is selling them. Like everything else on TV, once you buy it or get it, you realize that is a lie. But what God has given us is the truth. The Bible says it's impossible for our God to lie. That all of his promises are yes and amen. He says, if it were not so, I wouldn't have told you. And I'm going to tell you, I know this morning that heaven is real. I know that salvation is real. How do you know? Well, You can judge a witness, amen, by their character and by their testimony and promises that they have made. That's why when we get a witness on the stand, we attempt to impeach the witness by showing a pattern of lies. You've lied about this. You've lied about that. Well, of course you're lying about this thing that's coming to pass. But the opposite can happen as well. You get a witness on the stand, and they have been truthful. They have been truthful about everything. They have promised us joy, and we've received it. They have promised us peace, and we've received it. They have promised us satisfaction, and we've received it. They say, whatsoever you ask in my name, that you receive, and we have received it. Now, I make you the head, not the tail. We have received it. I will provide for you. We have received it. I will heal you when you get sick. We have received it. There's a pattern of truth there. I don't even have to see heaven yet. I know it's real. Because the testimony of my Lord has been yes and amen since the moment I got saved. You tell them about it. The abundant life, the eternal life. You tell them all the words of this life. You see? You tell them about the precious life of Christ. He died on the cross for our indiscretions. He bled, suffered, died, buried in the tomb on the third day. Died as a sacrifice for our sins. Everything you did wrong, he died to pay for your wrongs. And that payment you can receive for your sins for absolutely no cost, no charge to you. And there's no bill you're going to receive later. You receive it by grace through faith. You admit you're a sinner. You believe in Jesus Christ, all the facts about his life, and you confess him as your Lord and Savior. This morning, you could be saved. There's somebody here living, but dying to live. I set before you an open door this morning. Not just the open door of opportunity of success, but the open door of the kingdom of heaven. Don't be like my dog and stay outside. You got to come on in. I can't make you come on in. I can open the door, walk you to the door. You're going to have to cross that threshold yourself. We're about to have an altar call, amen. And listen, if you for any reason doubt your salvation this morning, you can come. You can come and be saved. You can come and admit and believe and confess, and God's going to save you right now. But also for our Christians, if you're here, and you saved already, amen, but you sitting at the open door. You're in the same place, or even worse. You've allowed fear to grip you, and you just saying, we're going to die here. We're going to die here. The devil is a liar. All right? All right? I want to pray for you that you would not sit on the sidelines watching everybody go through the door, watching people do extraordinary things, but that you would be extraordinary, ladies and gentlemen, for the Most High God, yourself. Oh, you got to hear me up in here. So at the altar call, listen, I can't stay long, amen, but the altar is open. If you need the altar, come. You know it's the Lord's Supper. If you got some things you got to discuss with your maker, come. Hey, the altar is open. Hallelujah. Come on up in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. You've heard the gospel. You've heard the clarion call. You've heard what God expects out you. You've seen the limits placed on your life. But God wants to break those limits this morning. He wants to take those limits off. We need to renew our mind and began not to just say the scriptures, but live them and believe them. My Bible says nothing shall be impossible for those that believe. So why you this morning? Why there's some things you think you can't do? We're going to pray, saints. We're going to pray. We're going to pray. And ushers for communion, y'all can come up as well. We're going to do that right after we pray. Somebody say, Lord. God. Most High. Abba. Thank you. For loving me. I admit. I sinned against you. And I'm sorry. Now, Lord. Save me. A sinner. I believe. That Jesus Christ. Died on the cross. For all my sins. I believe. That he rose. On the third day. I believe. That he's coming back. Now, Lord, save me. Use me. Bless me. Take the limits off my life. Take the fear out of my life. I want to do great things. So turn me loose in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, give God some glory. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Ushers, y'all can come with the Lord's Supper. Amen. This is the way we're going to do it, saints. Amen. So we won't go over time too bad. Just go ahead and take you one. Amen. And return to your seats. We do have some stations in the back where you can take you one and get you one. There's a I call you out. Oh, there's a message. I used to lay hands to on people. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Y'all go ahead and get your communion. Go ahead and get it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's some exciting times, saints. You're about to take the limits off. We're going to have business owners, doctors, lawyers, judges, political heads. My prayer is that America, my church, city councilmen, school board members. Hey, nothing is impossible. Congressmen, senators, hey, ambassadors, secretaries on a national level, vice presidents, presidents, nothing shall be impossible. Hey, millionaires. Billionaires, CEOs, hey, nothing shall be impossible. Hey, somebody right now, renting a house. Don't even have a place to stay. You gonna own rent houses? You gonna own apartment complex? Nothing shall be impossible. Nothing. You just gotta walk through. Just walk through. I'll go with you. Duck will go. We'll walk through. Send me an angel. Lord, we thank you for your body, which was broken for us. We are so grateful, God, because we realize that the law was against us and there was no way we could make it without you. We thank you for fulfilling the law perfectly on our behalf. We thank you for saving us by faith through your grace. We thank you for the body that was broken. The Bible says on the same night that he was betrayed, the Lord took the bread, gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, take and eat all of it. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Lord, today we remember you and declare we will never forget you, because it's through your body that we are reconciled to the Most High God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's eat together. After supper, he took the cup. And in the same manner, he told them, he says, drink all of it, drink. This is my blood of the new covenant. Recognizing that without the blood, there can be no remission of sins, for the life is in the blood. The only way to pay for sin was with a life, for the wages of sin is death. But I thank God this morning that the blood washes away all of our sins. This is the blood, as the Bible says, of the new covenant, the new deal that God has made with his people. No longer trying to get to heaven through the old covenant, but the new covenant, where we come in and the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus makes me whole, clean. What could wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Let's drink together. Thank you, Lord, for your blood and your body. Thank you, Lord, for your people. Thank you for their patience. Thank you for this grand opportunity. Thank you for this time which we live in. Thank you that we can do great things in your name. We're going to sing that doxology, saints, and then we're going to get out of here. Amen. And enjoy our weekend. Hallelujah. On three, we're going to do it. One, two, three.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below.
Praise him above.
Praise him.
Oh, that sound good. That sound good. That sound good. Hallelujah. Heavenly
host.
Praise Father, Son.
Praise Father, Son. And Holy Ghost.
And the church say, come on, give the Lord some glory, saints. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you. And may he bless you. Bless you. With peace and prosperity. It's your year. It's your year. You're going to. You're going to do great things. You're going to do great things. Great things. Great things. Love you. Great things. Love y'all, Philadelphia. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Love y'all. Hallelujah. Whoa, my people. Oh.